So I just want to pick up on what Mike Billington ended with when he said that first time that he met Linda LaRouche was in 1972. And didn't have all of Mike's presentation, but I'm sure he told me what had happened before 1972, but in March, in August 15th of 1971, was the breakup of the Bretton Woods system under Nixon, and it was an imposition of a shift of the United States economy away from physical production, away from science, away from technology, self-development infrastructure, towards currency speculation, towards austerity. And also the founding at that point of an organization called the Club of Rome. They put out a book in 1971 called The Limits to Growth that Lyndon LaRouche and our movement organized against and attacked. Specifically, the idea that this book was based on, that they basically what they did is they used a series of computer models based on existing technology and saying that no scientific advances would occur, and then based on that presumption, they proceeded to forecast what would happen as civilization ran out of a fixed resource base that they had essentially declared by outlying science. Now, someone who also attacked this idea of limits to growth is someone I want to briefly mention as an introduction to the presentation. And that's this person here. Has everyone heard of Krafft Ehricke before? Yeah, anyone not heard of Krafft Ehricke? Okay, well, Krafft Ehricke was one of the German scientists that was recruited by the United States at the end of World War II. Just very briefly, this is not going to do justice to him in terms of who he is, that people should find out more about him. But he was one of the people who was totally inspired by a movie put out in the early 1900s by Fritz Lang called The Woman on the Moon. This is a fictional movie put out about how you would get from the Earth to the Moon. And this movie that Krafft Ehricke went to see a dozen times. And he basically convinced his parents to get him develop for him a library in terms of science, in terms of what he would need to know in order to realize this. He became, during World War II, he was involved in World War II. He was thankfully recruited to the rocket program at Peenemünde and managed to escape and be recruited by the United States as part of what was called Operation Paperclip, which was recruited a lot of these German scientists and they came to the United States and helped build the United States space program. And in terms of his technical accomplishments, he was responsible for many ideas that built not only the United States program, but were essential to space programs internationally, like, for example, the idea of using liquid hydrogen as a fuel in liquid oxygen. Tremendous advance and necessary for the space program, particularly the landing on the moon. But beyond the technical accomplishments that Krafft Ehricke had was a certain philosophical outlook that he had, which he shared with our movement. As I said before, that there was this book put out by the Club of Rome, with limits of growth that our organization attacked. Linden LaRouche wrote a book called No Limits to Growth in the 1980s, attacking this book. Krafft Ehricke approached this from the standpoint of what he called the extraterrestrial imperative. He said if you look at the development of life on Earth, the shift in terms of the biosphere from the earlier under which life existed on Earth using chemical sources of energy to fuel life, the shift to use chlorophyll to be able to capture light coming from the sun and turn this into food, this was a fundamental advance that revolutionized life on Earth. And you compare this to what mankind does. You have a certain fixed resource base under existing level of technology, so you require discovery of a new principle that allows you to totally transform the way that your species functions. So from this standpoint, Krafft Ehricke, Krafft Ehricke actually had a book by the name of The Extraterrestrial Imperative that was prepared for publication in 1971. He was not able to find a publisher at that time. He kept speaking about this project. I'll just read this, get an idea of what he's talking about. As far from being isolated in space, Earth is a spaceship with external supplies. The most fundamental commodity, energy, comes from an external source. Terrestrial environment and biosphere run on the 1.5 billion kilowatt hours of solar energy intercepted annually. Earth and space are indivisible. Only a few centuries ago did man begin to understand this indivisibility in terms of natural laws. Now we experience it by going into space and returning that grid, and by conversing with our automated scouts all over the solar system. In a few years, this indivisibility will express itself in the productive, industrial use of extraterrestrial environments.
If you can just talk a bit louder, because I don't think the camera can hear everything you're saying.
The next slide, three fundamental laws of astronautics. This is something, an idea that Krafft Ehricke had been working on much earlier. In fact, in 1957, he published a book called The Anthropology of Astronautics. And what he laid out is what he called the three fundamental laws of astronautics. You can read here. The first law, nobody and nothing under the natural laws of this universe imposes any limits on man except man himself. Second law, not only the Earth, but the entire solar system and as much of the universe as he can reach under the laws of nature are man's rightful field of activity. The third law, by expanding through the universe, man fulfills his destiny as an element of life, endowed with the power of reason and the wisdom of the moral law within himself. Now, idea, that philosophical commitment, if you sort of look at where the world is today and what has to be accomplished in the world, it basically, to return the United States, as I'm sure Mike went into, return the United States and nations in Western Europe, places like Canada, to rescue them from a certain geopolitical conception that has been put forward entirely antagonistic to what Krafft Ehricke just said. And I just want to briefly, I'm not going to develop this in very much more than just a very brief sketch, but to give people a sense of how this played out. You had the launching by the Soviet Union in 1957 of the Sputnik satellite. This is a picture of the Pravda newspaper coverage of this development. And this was a real shock. You had also, the Soviet Union was really on a trajectory that sort of caught the United States and other countries under this geopolitical paradigm where the world was divided between the United States on the one side and the Soviet Union on the other side. It really sort of caught the United States with its pants down to a certain extent. You had whole series of developments. The first man in space was Yuri Gagarin in 1961. He circled the Earth, I think it was 14 times, and returned to the Earth. You also had, in this brief period, I think actually in 1959, the Soviets sent a space probe around the moon to take a picture of the far side of the moon. So it's a whole series of developments of this type. And so you sort of think of what we have to do. Lyndon LaRouche has been placing a lot of emphasis on the importance of Keisha Rogers, who was a successful candidate for the United States Congress, both in 2010 and in 2012, when she won the nomination for the nominee for the Congress in the 22nd District of Texas, which is the district where you have the Johnson Space Center. And she campaigned on the basis of reviving the space program, impeaching Obama, returning to this philosophical conception that was best expressed by Krafft, Ehricke, and people who reflect this thinking. But to give people a sense of what it is that we have to rescue the United States, rescue Western Europe, and to a certain extent also rescue Canada from, sort of just briefly reference some of these things. You had John Kennedy's speech at Rice University in Texas in 1962, famous quote, "See, they will choose to go to the moon not because it's easy, but because it's hard." And as people, we've published a lot of material on this on our website. If you look at some of the speeches that John Kennedy was making, he was very aware of the necessity of breaking the United States out of this geopolitical game in terms of having cooperation with the Soviet Union. You had these ongoing dialogues between President Kennedy and Khrushchev during the early 1960s, which had not had that kind of dialogue, which we don't have today, between the President of the United States and Putin. You could have well had a nuclear showdown occur. So the space program that John Kennedy committed the United States to played out, as people are aware, 1969, the first landing of the man on the moon in 1969, other developments that I'm not going to go into that the Soviets did, but that other nations had other activities in space. But keep in mind that these were developments that were playing out in one sense, very positive developments in terms of this space program, but also operating within a certain environment defined by this geopolitical confrontation between one side versus the other. And you had, with this no limits to growth faction, and the destruction of the Bretton Woods system in 1971, you had a move to shut down, particularly the space program. Krafft, Ehricke referred to the prior to the landing of man on the moon in 1969, a speech that the vice president of President Nixon, Spiro Agnew, gave, where he referred to the intention that existed within NASA to actually launch a manned program to Mars, and he said that this would cost $200 billion. But he neglected to tell Americans what would the benefits of this program be. And this sort of fed into a situation where you created pessimism under conditions where the benefits of these kind of programs were not laid out. So we see where we are right now in terms of the space program in the United States, essentially with the space shuttle program that was decommissioned under the Bush administration. Bush administration had put forward the idea of the Constellation program, which was to be a rocket to replace the space shuttle to be able to allow the United States to get back to the moon to resume a lunar manned lunar mission. This was killed by Obama in 2010. And so you have really now a situation where the United States is really, under Obama in particular, has essentially tried to kill the space program for all effective purposes. So in this kind of situation, if you look at the developments that are occurring, and also during this period you have with the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991, and then during the 1990s, if you think about what happened to Russia, in terms of the collapse in the population, the deliberate looting of Russia that occurred, and essentially Russia lost an entire generation in terms of the skilled manpower, the capability to maintain a space program in a water, in the capabilities that it has. So Russia has an idea to return to the space program. The United States needs to return to the space program. Other nations have to revise their commitment to the space program. So from that standpoint, you think about the importance that China plays in this process. Helga LaRouche has emphasized the stunning development over the recent 30 years is what China has done within a 30-year period of lifting 600 million people out of poverty. And you think about the developments that have occurred in China. In the year 2000, China had how many miles of high-speed rail?
Less than two.
Zero. And what does it have now? I think it's something like 16,000 kilometers of high-speed rail. So tremendous development. Now, in terms of the space program per se, Chinese had a space program in the sense of launching rockets. They had a certain response after the Sputnik launch themselves. But it was really only in the early 1990s that they actually set up a manned space program, 1993, and at the beginning of their launch vehicles that would that ultimately are carry people into space, the Shenzhou program. The first launch of that program was in 1999. Okay, so this is the Shenzhou 5. China puts the first man into space in 2003, 14 orbits around the Earth in 21 hours. This is how they're touching down. This is the Shenzhou 7 space craft, which had just released a small satellite that took a picture of the main craft. This is in 2008. And then on the same space craft, you have the astronaut doing the first spacewalk. Then Shenzhou 9 in 2012, China's first female astronaut on board. Shenzhou 10, you see here the Shenzhou 10 spacecraft, you see the left side of the screen. We're docking with the Tiangong 1. This is the first module of what will ultimately be China's space program.
And their space station.
Yeah, their space, the first module of their space program, space station. And the China's first woman in space, Wang Yaping. This is the next generation of Shenzhou 11, docked with a significantly larger space laboratory, which is what the Tiangong 1 was. It's about 14 and a half meters long. This is going to be planned to be launched in 2016. In 2018, China is going to be launching a module, a core module, which I think is this one stretching up to the left-hand side of the screen there. In 2018, and then with the existing modules of the Tiangong 2, that technology, they would have the skeleton of their space station, and they're basically saying that this can be expanded to six modules, and they're inviting international cooperation, countries to be able to manufacture themselves modules that would fit in this space station. The idea being, having laboratory capabilities to be able to do research in space. So that's in terms of the manned space program. Then in terms of the lunar program, the person who really has sort of devoted himself to this question of what to do with the moon is this person, Ouyang Qiwan. He's a geologist and an astrochemist, and standing in front of the globe there of the moon. this, in terms of the lunar program, it had a series of Chang'e probes that were launched first in 2007. The Chang'e 1 probe was launched. It went around the moon several times. It did an extensive mapping of, the altitude, sort of like a geological mapping of the altitude of the site, and also it did the first mapping that we have in terms of helium-3 concentrations, which I don't know if people are necessarily aware of. Helium-3 is a rare isotope of helium that is not very much off on Earth, but it's very desirable to have a supply of it because it would be the perfect fuel for thermonuclear fusion. Because unlike relying on the hydrogen isotopes, deuterium or tritium, fusion with helium-3 can be conducted in such a way to produce all electrically charged particles, which should be able to be contained by a magnetic or electrical field. So that's much better in terms of designing the reactor field controlled through the plasma. So that was successful. On the 2010, the next lunar probe, Chang'e 2, was launched. And if you look at the flight path of the Chang'e 2 satellite, you get an idea of how, in terms of the rate of development of China's launches, it's not as fast necessarily as what the United States was doing, during the 1960s and 70s, where they were sort of launching things sort of on a weekly basis. But you see that they do something, they learn something from what they've done, and they do something different the next time around. So that you can see here the flight path from the Earth out to the Moon, and initially we have a very highly elliptical orbit, and you adjust the orbit until it becomes circular and close to the Moon, about 100 kilometers away. And that's the location from which they would have done these mappings of the Moon. And then once that mission was completed, the spacecraft flew out to a place called L2. This is what's called the Lagrange point. It's a certain point about 60,000 kilometers farther away from the Moon along the axis with the Earth, where you essentially have a gravitationally neutral area where it's a semi-stable area where you don't have to expend fuel in order to keep the spacecraft stationary. So it circulated around this point, and this is the ability to do this is going to be important for future developments that China and other people want to do. And then once they demonstrated the ability to be able to do those manipulations, as you can see, the Chang'e 2 satellite was given a new mission to fly off to encounter an asteroid. Let's see it there. Yeah, this is the asteroid here. Two Capets. This is the L2, the range point.
Encounter for what?
In order to find out what the asteroid was. I mean, because I'm not going to go into this in the presentation per se, but particularly Ben Denniston of the Roche PAC science team has done a lot of work on this question of the dangers posed to mankind by the fact that there are millions of asteroids within the near Earth environment. Some of them are relatively small, some of them are big enough to do significant damage. And so you want to know where these are, what the trajectories are, and also if you are thinking in terms of what would you do if you knew there was an asteroid headed your way, how do you stop it? Well, you have to know what it's made of. Is it a solid rock like granite? Is it something that would break apart if you impacted it? So you have to investigate these kind of questions. Aside from very scientific questions that we'd like to know as well. Okay, so the Chang'e 3 lunar lander, this is the one that was launched beginning of December in 2013, and people probably know about this. It landed on the moon before Christmas on the 14th of December. See the flight path there. Okay, this is the moon lander on the left and the U-2 rover on the right. So this rover has been, I'm not sure if it's still functioning or not. I haven't looked up the latest material, but it has a whole series of instruments, including the ability to do ascents down to like 100 meters under the lunar surface to get an idea of what the geological profiles are. And it's doing much more close mapping of mineral resources, probably also helium 3 is one thing that they're looking at close up. Area. We're taking photographs, not only the visible, but in the ultraviolet, taking the ability to do astronomy on the moon where you don't really have an atmosphere like Earth to get in the way. Then the Chang'e 5P, this is a test for a mission that the Chinese want to do to be able to go to the moon and bring back a sample of lunar material. So they're testing the technologies that are involved in this. So this was launched in October of 2014, and you see here the flight paths, you know, going from the Earth out to where the moon is going to be. See that? Here's the moon. This is the moon will be here once it's up there, and then the return path. On the trip, it came quite close to the moon within 12,000 kilometers. Reaching Earth on the way back, once the spacecraft was within 5,000 kilometers of the Earth, it's basically guiding this return module, sort of directing it around the moon and on a trajectory that will lead it back to Earth. Because the return capsule, which would have the sample that they collected from the moon, it itself doesn't have any propulsion or guidance capability, so you need the service module that has the propulsion and guidance capability, put it into a position where it can re-enter the Earth's atmosphere, what they call a skipped re-entry, so it sort of enters the atmosphere, it slows down, and then skips out of the Earth's atmosphere, and then much more slowly, slow down significantly so that it can go down and be slowed down by parachute. And this is the slide, Chang'e 5T1 lunar sample return test mission return vehicle. You see this vessel has gone through the Earth's atmosphere, scorched with the high temperatures, but basically survived. So they've demonstrated the technology. The next slide, this is when the service module and the return module are approaching the Earth, the service module disconnects from the return module once it's entered it on the right orbit. And then what it does is it fires the engines for a certain period of time to sort of pull away from the Earth and set up an orbit so that it puts it on a trajectory that will bring it back to the moon. On a trajectory that will extend into a place that they want to be. And essentially, you don't see the trajectory here. You see the Earth, you see this is the orbit of the moon around the Earth. What you don't see is the trajectory of the Chang'e 5P going back to the moon. And then once it passes the moon, what it does is it does a series of orbital maneuvers to get out to this Lagrange gravitational neutral place that I was indicating, the L2 place, and it conducts an orbit around this point. Because it's not entirely stable. If you just stay at the point, you have to keep moving around it. So after demonstrating that the spacecraft could do that, it changed the trajectory again, as you can see here, and headed back for the moon. And so you see it coming back to the moon in a high in the elliptical orbit, and now it's got to change the trajectory from a very highly elliptical orbit into a more and more circular orbit, which it ultimately does, and it developed an orbit over 100 kilometers altitude above the moon. Okay, so that, before we just, once you're in that orbit, say 100 kilometers above the moon, this was a mission demonstrating the technology. The next mission that they want to do, they want to send the Chandra 5 lunar sample return mission to the moon. So they've demonstrated the technology to be able to once they've collected the sample, be able to send it back to the Earth, and it gets through the Earth's atmosphere, and it survives, it doesn't burn up. But with the Chandra 5 lunar sample return mission that they're going to launch in 2017, what they will do is they will put the spacecraft into a circular orbit around the moon, like you see here. And then once you have the spacecraft in the lunar orbit, you have the different components of the spacecraft. One component stays in the lunar orbit. Okay. One component, you know, goes down to the lunar surface and lands, and like the Chandra 3 mission earlier. Okay, this is the lunar lander module. It has the propulsion capability and the guidance, and this is the rover that roves around the surface of the moon looking for interesting things to find and map out. So the Chandra 5 mission sample return will have that same kind of capability. It might be some technically different capabilities, but it's basically the same kind of idea. And so that would be going from lunar orbit down to the surface of the Earth, collecting the lunar sample, and then lifting off from the lunar surface, going up into rendezvous with the Chandra 5 part that it will dock with it, and then once you have that, then you'll do what they've demonstrated with this Chandra test mission, be able to send it back to Earth, enter it into a trajectory where it can go through the Earth's atmosphere and be recovered. They're developing all these technologies to do that. And after the Chandra 5 mission, they also are in the process of upgrading the capability, the lift capability for the rockets that they use. The rocket that you see here can be scheduled for 2017, has a larger lift capability than they've used before. The importance of this helium-3, China just recently conducted a breakthrough test of their superconducting tokamak. They had over 100 seconds of the tokamak plasma at over 50 million degrees, okay, which the next test, they want to be able to get over 1,000 seconds, and they ultimately want to get the temperature up to around 100 million degrees, the conditions under which you can get a plasma that will conduct thermonuclear fusion and sustain itself. So the idea that they're going to be able to have helium-3 to be able to supply these reactors is what they're moving towards. Now this is the other thing. They had a Chandra 4 lunar lander that they originally had as a backup in case something went wrong with the Chandra 3 mission, and they didn't need it. So they're now repurposing this Chandra 4 lunar lander to go to the backside of the moon. Now this is one challenge that was not faced with the Chandra 3 missions, or the missions, frankly, not only of China, but nobody has landed anything on the far side of the moon so far. One of the challenges you have is if you have the moon, you know, in between you and the Earth, how do you communicate? Because you've got this big body. So what they actually have to do is use the technology that they have already developed, show that they can do in terms of this orbit around the L2 Lagrange point. It will have a satellite in that orbit, so that will be able to have communications between the Earth and the satellite, and the satellite communicating with the spacecraft on the surface, far side of the moon. Finally, just wanted to end here. This is a quote taken from Krafft Ehricke. Again, to return to this, the importance of this, he said, "The moon offers the first opportunity to open our world on Earth. In an open world, there are no limits to growth." So there's a lot more to Krafft Ehricke that I'll just sort of give a brief glimpse of here, but. If you sort of think of the developments that exist now in the world, the fact that China is now moving on this Silk Road perspective, China is now collaborating with Russia also in space. I mean, Russia's space program suffered a lot in terms of during the 1990s, the whole destruction of the Russian economy, the collapse of the Russian population. So the ability to collaborate with China and to be able to rebuild this capability, this is what they're also offering to the United States and other nations around the world as in their space stations, that they're inviting countries to design modules that will be part of this space station, to complete the space station. So basically, I think I can almost leave it there.
Say, oh, but what do you mean Obama is shutting down the space program? Didn't he just announce an asteroid mission? And I was hoping you could maybe say something that describes a little bit the difference between what the U.S. asteroid mission is and how it's different and lesser in conception than what we have coming out of Russia or China.
For example, I showed that China, in one of their first lunar missions, they actually, once the main mission was accomplished, in this Chang'e 2 mission, they said, okay, there's an asteroid out there, let's go and take a look at it. So it is the case that if you have millions of asteroids in your neighborhood, you don't know what their trajectories are, you don't know what they're made of. As Ben Denniston has been emphasizing, you do want to work with Russia and China and other countries that have the capabilities to get a mapping of what this asteroid population looks like. And you do want to take a look at what these things are, how they're made of. But you have to look at it from the standpoint that if you don't have the ability to function. The man's ability to function outside the Earth per se, Krafft Ehricke, as he said in this last quote, basically, the existence of a moon is the base from which we operate in order to be able to do things that we can't otherwise. The ability to operate in satellites around the Earth or the development of a space station around the Earth, that's a first step. The ability to be on a body like the moon, develop industrial capabilities, Krafft Ehricke had a whole program in terms of how you would industrialize the moon, how you would develop the resources of the moon. They include helium-3, include thorium, include probably uranium, other materials to be able to manufacture. If you're going to, for example, if you want to go to Mars in terms of developing a fleet of ships that go to Mars, you don't want to go from Earth directly to Mars, because the amount of fuel you would have to carry in your rocket would be just too prohibitive. You would never be able to do it. The existence of a space station allows you to have certain space vessels that can dock with the space station and conduct certain operations to be able to go, for example, between a space station around the Earth and the Moon. But ultimately, if you want to build larger space flotillas, you would want to have a manufacturing capability that a lot of the bulk and the mass of these spaceships come from the lunar resources. You would certain components you would bring from Earth, some of the lighter components, but most of it you would build in terms of mass on the moon. But you know, as people who were in NASA realized that, this idea, I mean, keep in mind that, it was a continual changing of the goalposts. If you sort of look at this long trajectory, that Krafft and Ehricke in 1971 basically put forward this philosophical conception of why the extraterrestrial imperative, that it's a natural evolution of mankind to not be trapped on Earth, but to, be able to go within into space, to develop the moon, to develop the solar system. And you have to do it in, a certain order. If you proceed to, sabotage the essential elements that are required to do that, not having lunar missions, not having the capability of maintaining even the planetary exploration, this is coming under attack. You know, this idea of going to Mars on a one-way trip, basically, you can't do it to do that. There's no reason to go out and, rendezvous with, an asteroid. You have automatic, unmanned probes that can, do things like that and find it with a mate-up. There's no reason to, risk human life and that sort of thing, particularly when there's no other underlying program.
He foresaw helium-3, external supplies. Could you explain to me, what's the model of helium-3 energy-wise for the future of humanity?
Well, helium-3, if you have the development of thermonuclear fusion, most of the research going on, it uses the isotopes of hydrogen. Deuterium, which has one positively charged proton in the nucleus and has a neutron, so it has a, mass of two. And then you have tritium, which has one proton positively charged and two neutrons. Okay? And the problem with that is when you combine the deuterium and the tritium, you end up generating neutrons, which are uncharged. You can't contain them. They react with the neutrons, sort of hit the, walls of the fusion reactor, and, they can transform the, iron or the other elements of your vessel into other different elements. Now, that, this is not a roadblock in terms of developing fusion, but it's just that it's much better if you could do fusion using helium-3, or you could either react helium-3 with itself and you generate entirely electrically charged particles, or if you react helium-3 with deuterium, you can suppress the amount of neutrons produced to a, much lower level. It requires a higher temperature to be able to do this. It's more challenging, but you know, these are, problems that can be solved. So the idea of having a plasma that can be controlled with a magnetic field, and, you don't have neutrons slipping through the magnetic field and, damaging the reactor. Yeah.
We have time for one more question. There's
Bob, I find it also very interesting the difference when, for example, the government is having a program, or when this private guy, Musk, wants to do trips to the moon and to Mars.
It's as I say, it's the idea of actually dismantling the capability of maintaining a space program. I mean, if you want to shut down and destroy the space program, you don't necessarily just shut it down. You say, okay, we're going to do this instead, knowing that it's something that's not going to function.
And here, when you have it like from the government, you have a whole population like in China now. All excited. They're all participating.
I think, for example, these, I'm not sure what the case is right now, but the SpaceX company, they were basically depending on rockets being produced by, Ukraine. So again, this is a problem. If you have, not just within the space program per se, but if you have a geopolitical view of mankind, that mankind is trapped on Earth, mankind's not supposed to be able to develop or create abilities to change the universe, like Krafft Ehricke is talking about, then you create sort of circumstances under which, you know, even your limited prospects really don't function.
So,
So in other words, it requires at any cost a collaboration between countries and nations.
Yeah.
It cannot be implemented as such
yeah.
without any possibility of cooperation.
Yeah, there's a various quote that I didn't read from Krafft, Ehricke. I'll just read some of these to get people a better idea.
Yeah.
Let's see. Yeah, this is Krafft, Ehricke in this 1957 book called The Anthropology of Astronautics. It says, the concept of space travel carries with it enormous impact because it challenges man on practically on all fronts of his physical and spiritual existence. The idea of traveling to other celestial bodies reflects to the highest degree the independence and agility of the human mind. It lends ultimate dignity to man's technical and scientific endeavors. Above all, it touches on the philosophy of his very existence. As a result, the concept of space travel disregards national borders, refuses to recognize differences of historical or ethnological origin, and penetrates the fiber of one sociological or political creed as fast as that of the next, which is what you would perceive. And in spite of all these conflicts between the United States and Russia, the United States can't get up to the space station without depending on Russian rockets. And you have this collaboration going on, which is sort of fragile, but this is one of the indications of it.